Well, greetings to all of you who are able to participate today. It's certainly not a way that we want to gather as believers, as a believing community, and I know this has been very daunting, but be assured that the Archbishop, my brother priests, and myself have increased our prayers for all of you. Speaking of daunting, the Archbishop Vigneron has asked me to preach today at this Liturgy of the Lord's Passion. It seems in the situation that we find ourselves that it's a little weightier than normal as we focus at today's liturgy on suffering and death. We have gone through, as someone said, the lentiest Lent in all of our memories. We have been confronted by suffering and death. Not just today, but for weeks, we have been facing suffering and death. Some of you might even have someone missing from your table because they're fighting the virus in a hospital, or God forbid, maybe some of you are missing someone who has succumbed to the virus and you weren't able to celebrate a funeral liturgy in the way that you wanted. Like many of you, I too have family members who are on the front lines working those long hours in caring for all the sick. For some of you, you might be experiencing the suffering of loneliness or the suffering of isolation, the suffering of job loss. Maybe you find the challenge of not being able to pay your bills or not even having enough to eat. So to reiterate, we are experiencing a time of suffering and death. But as this is a Lent like no other, the death we celebrate today, and I want to say that again, I said that correctly, the death that we celebrate today, in this liturgy, it's like no other. I believe that what we do here can help us to put in perspective what is happening out there. Here we celebrate the confrontation of death and life itself. So since all of this began, I've had the opportunity to counsel some folks over the phone as they've experienced all this challenge. And some have asked me, and I think erroneously, they've asked me, you know, why has God caused this virus? Because he didn't cause this virus. Or they've asked that unanswerable question, why is God allowing this to happen? And most likely these questions have originated out of the emotions of anger and fear. It's completely understandable, but if that's how we look at this situation, out of fear, out of anger, of why is God doing this? And I believe we're not necessarily looking through the correct lens. And just maybe, without even realizing it, we have become a little complacent in our understanding of life and of death and what that's all about. Society, our world has trained us to look at life only, to avoid focusing on death at all costs. This is not a fun thing to say, but whether it be next week, whether it be 50 years from now, we're all going to die. But you and I avoid looking at that because it causes us anxiety. I think it's a good thing for each of us to ask ourselves, then what is the understanding that we, Jesus' disciples, what should we have in our understanding? How should we embrace this? Now, you and I just heard this amazing, beautiful, powerful gospel proclaimed. But just maybe because we have heard it, I don't know, maybe so many times, maybe it's too long and we don't focus on it in the way we should. In a sense, each of us in our own way have allowed it to lose its power. Again, we just heard the confrontation of death and life itself. Jesus on the cross, the power of Jesus. That is the theme of this gospel. In order for us to embrace the power of Jesus, I want to share with you an old Russian legend. I've had this story in my files for about 25 years, And with this pandemic, I think it's about time that I pulled it out and used it. I like it because I think it helps restate our scripture's theme. I think it helps us to refocus our perspective. It's entitled, How Death Became Life. And this is how it begins. Death was born on a flaming day, at least that is how she remembered it. When she came forth full grown into the world, it was a light with the colors of fire. The light seemed to come from a sword which an immense angel held aloft, guarding a door to which she knew not where. At first, death felt like a stranger. She wandered, lost. One day she saw a beautiful bird with gorgeous plumage, and gently she walked up to it and she stretched out her hand to feel the softness of its feathers. But no sooner had her fingers touched it, the bird fell to her feet, cold and still. Death picked it up and wondered why it had stopped singing, why it had stopped living. This was how she discovered her dreaded power. Slowly, years flowed into eternity. Death traveled through them, touching this animal or this fish or this flower. And by this time, she knew the earth well. She noticed a certain kind of creature, human beings. They held in their faces a strange reflection of God. It was as if they had been made in the image of God. Death took a long time to touch humankind, but once she did, she tasted the fullness of her awesome power, and she knew loneliness to the very last drop. Centuries turned into millennia, and death claimed all living things for her own. Yet there was a hunger in her that grew and grew. In her silent kingdom, nothing remained. All living things crumbled and turned into dust at her touch. She was always left with loneliness. She almost grew mad with the loneliness and desired to have and to hold something that would last. It was a great time of plagues and storms, and tears flowed down her emaciated cheeks, and death crisscrossed the whole earth with the swiftness born of that frenzied hunger. Throwing herself at the children of human beings, she embraced them passionately, hoping against hope that she might see a smile or hear a word, lift the pall of loneliness that isolated her from all living things. But she learned that human beings feared her above everything, and she shrank, and then we shrank from her approach. One day, tired and weary, she sat on a hill beneath three crosses on which three men were executed. She did not feel like looking at or touching any of these. She was too tired. She was too lonely. So she just sat there, her weary head in her hands, and she wept, bemoaning her loneliness. Suddenly above her, she heard a voice. I thirst. She looked up and her gaze met two fathomless eyes. From their depths flowed a brilliant warm light, the likes of which she had never experienced. Immediately she stood up erect and tall and thin. She wanted to touch him with love and respect, but did not dare. Very self-consciously, she put her hands behind her back and she stared at the bleeding, disfigured face as if she could never, ever get enough. She heard him speak some short sentences, and each word she locked into her heart and she relished them. The very echo of the voice, weak with pain and hunger, moved her deeply. His eyes called to her in a wordless message. She gently touched his cheek. He seemed for an instant to smile at her alone. Then, like all the others before him, he closed his eyes and he became lifeless and cold. She knew that he was different from all the others. So she lingered a while and she saw him taken down from the cross. She saw his mother hold his lifeless body and cradle his ashen face. She saw them carry his body into a grave that was hollowed out of a cave. But just as the soldiers rolled the stone to the entrance to seal it, she entered just before it was put in place. What passed between him and death, no human being will ever know. But on the following Sunday, some women came to the tomb. Death was not there. Since that Sunday, all who look upon death with the eyes of faith see it differently. They see that love is life and death is only a gateway to eternal life. The end. So friends, in these crazy times, more than ever before, you and I need to embrace again what Jesus did for all of us. Sometimes we think that because Jesus is God, because Jesus is the Son of God, that he somehow suffered maybe less, like he was only play acting or something of that sort. But as we hear this gospel, we can only conclude that because he was the Son of God, he suffered more intently. His friends really did abandon him. Those were real thorns that pierced his head and his eyelids. That was warm spit, and it was real. That whip really made his flesh tear, and those were real spikes that pierced his flesh. The words, "Father, take this cup from me," that was a real cry that came from his lips. Jesus didn't suffer less, Jesus suffered more. And he did this for us. He did this for you. So as we walk with Jesus these final days before Easter, with all of the fear that's going on, with all of our questions, our anxiety, you and I need to grapple with the only force that can possibly overcome death, and that's God's love in Christ. This includes not just our physical death, but the death of our soul, which, as the church clarifies it, that's sin. So if we are burdened with guilt or sin, if we are burdened with a sense of dreadedness, if any of you are burdened with the pain of death, the death, I don't know, of relationships, of a marriage, of isolation, or overwhelmed in these uncertain times, if you are dealing with death of anything in any way, shape, or form, all these things are certainly causes for great sadness. Yes, we want to be recognizing that. But listen to the scriptures. The scriptures tell us, this Russian legend that I proclaimed for you, it retells us, this liturgy reminds us what it is that the Archbishop is celebrating here right now. This is the only thing that overcomes death, and it's God's love in Jesus. So in these few days before we celebrate Easter, in the midst of this crisis, let's meet this love. You and I are called today to reverence the cross. But before we do that, let's grab all that fear. Grab onto your fear. Take all the deadly things in our lives, including our sin, including our doubts, and let's hand them over to Jesus. Let's hand them over to Christ. And I invite you to make a confession right now. Make a confession in your heart and say right now, "Bless me, Jesus, for I have sinned. I have known death." And I want each of us to tell him that we want the burden lifted. You want to see life. Tell him you want to see life. Tell him you want to unleash the gospel. Tell him that, you know, t- tell God that you want to be alive again in your faith. Today, we don't celebrate death. We celebrate the life that we receive through the cross, through his passion. We celebrate that Jesus waits high on the cross to take away our death, whether it be physical, whether it be moral, whether it be a mental burden that you and I carry. In your prayerfulness, in your life, turn over everything to Christ. So in these uncertain times, remember, death is defeated. Only Jesus has power. Only his love is stronger than death.